shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are home and when you are away and when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand and fix them as an emblem on your forehead and write them on your doorpost of your house and of your gates. When I was in seventh grade, I went to my first play, and I was so excited to go to this play, and I just felt very grown up. Now, in reality, it was a high school play, and I don't know, in my mind and even in my memory, it seemed spectacular, but who knows, because it was a high school play, you know, but it was Fiddler on the Roof. And I remember being totally mesmerized by this one scene. It's a scene where the mother is praying on the Sabbath over the candles. And this prayer and this song has stayed with me for many years. And so Barry's going to play a clip from the movie for you to see it. That light and you being And it continued that candles were an important part of worship. They actually called them vigil light, which comes from the Latin, which means to be waiting and to be watching. That we light the candle as a symbol of Christ, the light in the world, and then we wait and we watch for the light to come, to the light to return. The practice of candle lighting, you know, receive favor in culture, popular culture, secular culture, as well as the church. And they used lights, they lit lights in the catacombs to remind them of the martyrs and the saints that have gone before them. Possibly on All Saints Day, you too have lit a candle to remind you of a saint in your life. Now, candle lighting is an important thing, but, you know, I was thinking, you know, is candle lighting an important enough spiritual discipline to have an entire sermon on it? Because, you know, I don't know if we need a whole sermon on candle lighting. But when I began to think about how taking that action, and it's even better when you do it with a match, and lighting a candle, and providing that glow of light, how it also leads us into deeper and other spiritual practices, such as prayer. That lighting a candle is a way of extending one's prayer. It's a way of saying that we are praying with intentionality. It isn't those little blip prayers that we might say all day as we work and as we are driving in our cars, but no, instead we are saying this moment is a prayer and an activity that we are paying attention to God. When we light a candle on behalf of someone, it is showing God that we have a continual and persistent desire to bring things to Him in prayer, to people and situations. The other day, I went down to visit, and my sister and I were talking, and we were talking about when we were young, lighting candles in church. My father had mentioned that every Sunday, my great niece lights a candle for my mother when she goes to church. And so I said, do they still have the little money box that you put your coins in for it? And he said, no, they don't have that anymore. And that it's actually, you're not lighting a candle, you're pushing a button and the little electronic candle goes on. I guess for safety purposes, that's the way they do it. We were talking about how much we missed, how she kind of lost out on this kind of experience of lighting a candle. Has anyone here ever lit a candle in church? Yeah. When in the Catholic Church, there were often stands of candles. And you lit a candle for a purpose, for a prayer purpose. So lighting the candle was the beginning of your prayer. They were long stick matches. And it was the smell of that flame. And then it was the action of lighting that tiny light. And then the glow that it would provide. There was a really special smell to lighting those candles. And there was a real sacredness of putting in your little money to pay for that candle to be lit that made a difference. And at the end, my sister reminded me, and I forgot about this, that you took the match and you stuck it into sand that they had there. And, you know, to make sure that you aren't going to catch the church on fire. It was the ritual that drew you in to this intentional and close moment with God. It was everything about it that even as you think about it, you can smell it and hear that money clinking. Singing the Shabbat prayer and lighting candles is a really important part of the Jewish traditions that they practice regularly. That each Sabbath, that it begins, the meal begins with this prayer and this singing. During communion, Barry will be playing a video that you'll be able to maybe look up at some point. And it's about modern Jewish families lighting candles at Shabbat. And it's about the fact that it isn't that quick, bless us for food, O Lord, amen, kind of situation. But there is an intentionality. And that the prayer goes beyond just blessing the bounty that we have right at that moment. But it is a time to really connect with God. Do this in remembrance of me. Today we will take part in communion. And what we do, the actual elements and the ritual helps us to connect and deepen our faith. It is a moment in which we are in the presence of the living God. And it is in doing that action of receiving that bread in your hand and then dipping it into the cup and that eating it, that reminds us that we are connected to Jesus in the same way as his friends and family were connected on that day that they gathered together to eat that meal. Now, the purpose of today is not for you to go out to buy a bunch of candles and start lighting them. And the connection of this whole series is not about adding more things to your life, but that Jude spoke about last week, commitment, is offering you ways to dig deeper into your faith and to live a committed life of faith. That you engage yourself completely and fully in the pursuit of loving God and loving your neighbor. That we began this with the prayers from the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is near. And it tells us to love the Lord our God with our whole heart, with our whole mind, and with our whole strength. And these spiritual practices give us a way to include our mind and our heart and our soul to loving God. That when we pray with devotion, that when we study with fervor, that when we give without hesitating, that we open ourselves to fasting and communion and candlelighting, all of those are ways in which we are more fully loving God. And that the fruit of loving God will be loving our neighbor. That it is recognizing that God is active and that he is ever at work in people's life, and he is inviting and directing and guiding and proposing and suggesting to all of us a new way to live. opportunities? And are we opening ourselves to responding? When we're running around, as my mom would say, like chickens with your heads off, well, guess what? We can't respond to anything. And each of these spiritual practices, what they do is they slow us down and they give us focus so that we can intentionally hear and therefore respond to Christ in our life. There is a question, and I wonder, when was the last time that you asked yourself, what more does God want of me? You see, at some point in our life, we probably asked, what does God want of me? And we probably, that's why we've landed here this morning in this space. You might have asked, what does God want of me? And therefore, we've had children or picked a certain job or even chose to live in a certain area. But do we continually ask, and then do we listen for the answer? What more does God want of me? One person wrote, engaging in spiritual practices as a guilt-motivated duty is just not helpful, for the disciplines are an invitation to an adventurous, wild romp with God, who is absolutely crazy in love with us. They are not an obligation, and they are best practiced simply as a reaction to God's love. When was the last time you felt like you took a wild romp with God? And if it hasn't been in the near past, then maybe we need to include some more intentional ways to connect with God. While studying and reading, and especially this piece on candle lighting and thinking about the fact of, is it even worth writing a sermon on this? One thing I came across was the fact that maybe people don't have enough opportunities in their life to actually respond to God in a way that allows them to pray or consider what God might be asking them. I've realized that as a community, we need to set up opportunities to respond to God at the end of the service. That on days like today, when we have communion, you have the opportunity that after the message, then when you are invited to come forward, that you can answer that invitation by coming forward. But what do we do on ordinary Sundays? We kind of maybe sing a song and say a prayer and that's the end. And there hasn't been an opportunity for you to respond. And so over the next few weeks, I'll be setting up stations to allow you to maybe light a candle as a response to God's love shared in this space. Or have communion even on Sundays when we don't have communion as a community. Or that someone will pray for you, that each and every Sunday that we'll have someone back in our prayer room waiting to pray for you. That as a response, we'll wrap prayer shawls around your shoulders and pray and believe in healing. One thing that this summer has taught me is life is short. And we never know when we will be called home. And therefore, we should not miss a single opportunity to pray, to join in with someone, to light candles, to study the Bible, to eat the meal that our Lord gave us. are not about trying something, but instead they're about training. And like all kinds of training, they take a lot of time. You know, we wouldn't expect to be able to just walk out of this space and run a marathon without ever training first. And in the same way, to have a deep and committed faith, we need to do some training beyond the moments that we spend in this space. And so I pray that you will think over the week about how God is calling you to create those moments in which you are deeply